Hello, I'm Jan, the creator and CEO of EnitN, a Berlin-based fair code licensed workflow automation tool. I guess most people never heard of fair code and have no idea what it means or what it stands for. That's totally okay, because that's the reason why I'm here today, to change exactly that. I will spend quite some time to talk about its origin. The reason for that is, and I think it's very important to know how it all started, to understand why fair code is so important and why it has to exist. So how did it all start? Last year I had worked on EnitN for around 1.5 years part-time. I did really believe in it and got more and more excited. But it was also very hard, stressful, and the progress was very slow. The reason was that EnitN was only a side project. I still had another startup and a part-time job to earn at least some money. So it was important for me that I can work on it full-time, or at least have a very clear path how to get there. I knew if I'm gonna open source it, somebody else will come along and offer it hosted. They will obviously gonna be much faster and better in doing that. After all they will have to do is that one thing. They will charge money for it, and I will be the one supporting the users, fix bugs, and add features, and all that for free. So I would not only compete with my own product, I would always be at a disadvantage because of that. Currently, I can see how true that is. Right now, we are working on the hosted version of EnitN, and in parallel, obviously, also still on the core product. Doing that at the same time is really hard. And that even though I'm now not alone anymore. Anyway, because of that, I was sure it's neither in my interest nor in the interest of the users, because the people behind the project are the ones that really push it forward, the ones that put the money they make directly back into the project. For external companies, that's normally not the case. So I looked for a solution, how to address these issues. I could have gone open core, but honestly, I really never liked it. It literally means I have to make my product artificially worse by taking important features away, just to make money. It seemed always like a bad idea. If I want my project to become successful and to get it adopted by as many people as possible, I can simply not afford that. So I was searching for a solution. Then I found a commons clause. That one allowed to restrict how projects are commercialized. It was exactly what I was looking for. Everybody can use it totally for free, but when they want to make money, they have to pay and get a special license. So that's what I chose, Apache 2 with commons clause, which means EnitN was not OSI approved open source. So when I launched, I called it open source in quotes, and wrote everywhere that it uses Apache 2 with commons clause just to make it perfectly clear. Additionally, did I also add a section to FAQ explaining exactly that. The reason why I called EnitN open source was simple. I thought for 99% of the people, it does not make a difference at all. The source code is open and it can be forked and used by everybody for free, no matter if it's a private person or company with 10,000 employees. The only difference is that they cannot charge money from other people. As there was no other proper term to describe that, I felt it was the clearest thing to do, to call it open source. And that's where the problem started. Maybe not directly, but as soon as I launched it on EnitN on Product Hunt and somebody else posted it on Hacker News. People started to saying, I'm lying, I'm misleading them, I'm wasting their time. Another person also said that I'm gaslighting people. So in short, they said I'm a simply horrible person. So it got actually so bad that EnitN stepped in. Hacker News stepped in. Interestingly, did they not ban the person that did misbehave? What they did instead is they changed the title of the post from something like EnitN Open Source Zapier Alternative to EnitN Workflow Automation Alternative to Zapier, which in my eyes was even more misleading to people. It made EnitN sound like a closed source SaaS product. They could have at least said something like self-hostable or source available. I'm really not a big fan of that term at all, but literally everything would have been better. Anyway, the same person which said that I'm gaslighting people also opened a GitHub issue with exactly that title. It got over 330 comments, so if any of you is ever bored, it's really an interesting read. In this issue, people demanded that I remove all open source mentions and replace them with source available. Apart from that, most people did never hear that term. The meaning is literally source available. So it describes a proprietary project where the code can be seen but not used, and also MIT licensed project alike, which kind of feels like it defeats the purpose. Why would I choose a term which does literally not have a meaning at all? So I was quite reluctant to do that. especially because of the way they did ask me. I had even lawyers write me, which said calling it open source is legally totally fine. I'm just not allowed to say OSI approved open source. This was for sure nice to hear, but it didn't really help to de-escalate the issue. I even had the president of the OSI reach out to me and discussed with him about possible solutions. I proposed some kind of level system. Open source alone without a level is the current definition. And then these additional levels add additional restrictions, like one adding like commercial restrictions. Even though he was like a very nice person, it was nice to talk to him, he never really warmed up to my idea. He could obviously not have decided it by himself anyway, but I just hoped that he would back it when I would propose it. As it didn't work, I had to find an alternative. And because I really did not want to give in, like, other people should not have to go through the same thing again that I just went through. After all, it seemed like to repeat itself again and again and again. That's when the idea of fair code was born, to give people an alternative term to use. The idea behind it was nothing new, but it was really important to have the term for a term for it. Only then do people know directly what to expect, know what is allowed and what is not allowed. Kenneth Malik, which was part of the GitHub discussion, reached out to me via email. He also had thought about an open source alternative. So when I was in San Francisco in the beginning of the year, I met with him, and we realized very fast that our ideas generally aligned. So we created over the next weeks the fair code definition and launched a website. Once it was ready, I changed the wording on the NNN website, and so NNN became the first official fair code project. But even after I switched there, there was still a discussion about me using the words free and open. They said I'm still misleading people and should be changed. So I guess the discussion is going to stay around for a while. So what is fair code exactly? Fair code means that the project is generally free to use and can be distributed by anybody. It has the source code openly available. It can be extended by anybody in public and private communities. And most importantly, it's commercially restricted by its author. So short, everybody can use it for free, but if you want to make money with it, you have to pay. So why would anybody choose fair code? Or let's say differently, what are the advantages? For project maintainers, which choose fair code is very clear. It increases the chance of having a long-term viable product and sustaining it long-term. But even OSI-approved open source projects win, because fair code projects are normally better off financially than its open source siblings. This allows the fair code projects to help them financially, like we do at NNN. After all, is it in the interest of the fair code projects that its dependencies are also properly maintained? Fair code, also the fair code users that use fair code projects have an advantage, because they can obviously still use the product totally for free, exactly like any other open source one. Additionally, do they know that the company behind it or the person is financially healthy, meaning will probably stay around for a long time, but also means that people can get hired to fix bugs, create new features, create documentation, and answer questions in the forum. Even companies which have to get a special license now because they want to integrate it in their paid offering, for example, that doesn't have to be bad. Sure, they're now forced to pay something, but the money does go directly into the project, a project they really depend upon a lot. So the money is not really lost. It helps to make the project better, but then also improves their offering. So in my eyes, it really sounds like everybody's winning. So what's next? The level system I proposed to the OSI is also something should still get added to fair code. Obviously, also an important thing, the most important thing is actually that more projects adopt it. And for that, fair code has to be better known, because unless people know what it means, users will be very hesitant to use fair code projects, and maintainers will also be very unwilling to adopt it. So if you can ask for a single thing, it would be, please spread the word. So if anybody has any questions, I'm obviously also very happy to answer them. Thanks. Ciao.